Colorado River is in a mega drought, and communities throughout the western United States are feeling the effects. Dan Rodrigo and his colleagues are helping these communities assess the risks and opportunities that come with this challenge. Check it out.
Climate change has already happened in the West significantly. For example, since 1955, the snowpack in the western United States decreased about 30 to 50%, according to EPA. Now, the problem with that is that 30% of Western water supplies come from snowpack. View that as sort of free storage up in those mountains. And in late spring, that water starts to melt. And by the summer, when demands are highest, that water becomes available to help recharge groundwater and surface reservoirs. But now the snow is significantly less, the snowpack's less. It's also melting earlier. So now that it's melting earlier, which is more like early spring, it really can't help us because all the reservoirs are full. So that water goes wasted to the ocean. That's what's happening with observed climate change. Looking forward, the situation looks even more bleak, right? It looks like we're going to have longer droughts, more frequent droughts. But we're also going to have opportunities like these strong atmospheric rivers that come through. Now, the intensity by which those storms happen requires different ways of managing water. We have to figure out quicker ways to store that water because it's coming with such great intensity. So we're going to need more storage. We're going to need to figure out better ways to get that water into the ground when those events happen.
Dan, you've been a pioneer in one water planning as a way to tackle these challenges. Can you define one water planning and explain how it works?
Yeah, I mean, one water is what it says. It's looking at the entire water cycle, both the actual natural cycle and the man-made cycle in terms of infrastructure. It's examining water, wastewater, and stormwater really as a more interconnected system. And by doing that, we uncover a lot more opportunities. So historically, those systems have been managed in silos, but by breaking down some of these barriers, having these different agencies work together, we can uncover different ways to optimize that system. So we can use stormwater as a way to recharge groundwater, for example, or we can even use it directly. We can capture it at the household level or the lot scale level and use it for irrigation. As you know, many states are moving forward with some form of indirect or direct potable reuse that allows purified wastewater to be used as a drinking source of water. That really gives us a lot more tools in our toolkit to deal with these issues that we've been talking about, like the Colorado River and in California, the multi-decades of droughts that they have had over the years.
CBM Smith is committed to helping communities strengthen their water supply portfolios to take on today's challenges and tomorrow's opportunities. Learn more at cbmsmith.com/reuse. All right, let's get back to Dan. When it comes to developing new water sources through desalination or potable reuse, how do you help communities assess the value of those opportunities 10, 20, 30, 50 years down the road?
So the first step is really to assess what we need in the future or what we think we're going to need. And how we do that is we use scenarios, right? Scenario planning. So working with stakeholders, we come up with alternative futures, if you will. We make our best projections of what growth is going to be and what climate change is going to be, and even technologies. And we use that to establish what we think we're going to need into the future. And then what we do is evaluate what I would call the no project alternative. You know, how often are we going to have water shortages? How severe are those water shortages going to be? And using various techniques, we can assign a dollar value to that lack of reliability. So what are the impacts of not having water for commercial and industrial activities? So there are ways that we have done that in the past. One is using a software called Implan, which is an economic input output model that can be applied really to any significant metropolitan area. The second is we can use contingent valuation surveys of residential customers and ask them under different situations how much they'd be willing to pay not to have shortages, not to have significant shortages, being able to have that quality of life, basically. And we can attach dollars to those kinds of results. And then we can unitize that on a per MGD basis or per acre foot basis and compare it to the unit cost of our supply options, our alternative supply options. When we have done that in California, we have found that even desalination is less expensive than the impacts of not having a reliable water supply using those techniques.
Dan, as always, a fascinating discussion. Thank you for being here with me today.
Yeah, no, thank you for having me. It's been a pleasure.